I'm here today with Maxim PandaCat Janovic, former hunter for eUnited, now mid player for Rival. Tell me about the game you chose and why.
So I think this is, we're watching game two versus Obey at Worlds. And I think this game, it kind of just sparked my thought that we're gonna win Worlds. Like when I dominated this game, well, it was my team and I, like when we played this game out and like when I looked at the score and like how well we played, I was like, there's no way we're gonna lose Worlds. Like, especially cause Obey was like a fan favorite and a personal favorite. Like we thought they were good and all, but every time we beat them, the fans were still cheering for them and not for us. It was like the most odd experience, but every time we beat them in this game specifically, I was like, if we just keep playing like we are, like we're winning Worlds. That's why I chose this game.
So the first thing I wanted to address in this game is the picks and bans. Going into it, what was your team's game plan? Were you worried about anything that Obey picked at all?
No. I mean, we knew like the game before this, Emilzy played Hell, and we knew that like maybe he'll play Hell, maybe he'll play it again, because he played in ranked, he played on stream. We were like, he might play it. Other than that, we just kind of wanted a draft for late game. Like we have the Fafnir, Rahu, Yi late game. We were just kind of, just didn't want to die early. Take it to late game. And like, we knew we were the better team fighting team. We knew we were the better objective forcing team. And this team in particular, what we noticed from game one was like, they just walk into objective. So we just picked a semi-pick comp with Fenrir, and then you just burst their front line, bait objectives, and you know, just keep bringing them in.
Now, was this Fenrir pick because of the pick idea? Was this because of a different reason?
Honestly, no. Our god pool for jungle coming into Worlds were the three gods that Scream played at Worlds, Bastet, Ravana, and Fenrir. And Ravana at the time was broken, so that was a given. Like, if you didn't play Ravana, yeah, you'd be benched. And then Bastet was banned here because he played in game one. Mm-hmm. So the only other pick we had was Fenrir. Scream just wasn't comfortable in anything else. Like, we asked him to play this and that, Nemesis, I'm in Thor, but no, it's just Bastet, Fenrir, if Ravana was.
I mean, it worked out for you guys considering you won Worlds at the end of the day, so that was nice. So let's just fast forward a little bit here to some dual lane action between you, PBM, and then also Scream's rotation. Talk me through this first blood.
So we see them pushing up. I see them pushing up, and I think we call Scream over from mid because all the back camps are down, all the neutrals are down, so this is a perfect time for a gank. Mike forces a jump, he flanks with the hammer, so his beads are down, we're calling that. Scream has his runes, so we're like, this is a free kill, Scream just come in. I think we miscommunicated who we're going on though, because he goes on the Uller, we go on the Ama, but it works out in the end. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we just call him over because we knew he was going to play up, they're going to play up. We have a pretty late game duo, they want to force their lead, so shutting that duo lane down early is like a huge deal for us.
And you got the first blood bounty, how did that make you feel?
At the time, it made me feel like super strong, but like as the game goes on, the lead decays quite a bit because I rotate, I help farm, I split farm. But like just the momentum, like as a personal momentum boost, like I just got first blood versus Obey at Worlds on Huyi as well, like not a great early game character. So I mean, personally, it was like a huge boost in like momentum and attitude as a team, and like we were just all so hyped.
Nice. So I wanted to go a little bit on the lighter side of things, a little bit of a mistake from Ataraxia going off right here when he accidentally fatty fingers his beads.
Can't be doing that, Ataraxia. I mean, we had no idea that he beads. Obviously, nobody's there to see it, but there were multiple times where the crowd would just start yelling. Like, they would just start going off, and we're like, it's 8 minutes into a game. We're like, what could they possibly be doing? Like, we have a lead, we have wards, but they're yelling. So when we watch back the games, it's funny to see like things like that where you fat finger a bead or an Aegis, and then you're like, oh, that makes complete sense as to why like nothing was going on. I'm walking to lane and everybody's cheering for us because he just beads in lane. So that was pretty funny to see after watching the game.
Was that much of a distraction ever, or is that like easy to get back into the game moment?
I think for many people, a crowd can be a distraction. Personally, and I know for many of the people on eUnited, like, the crowd was just fuel for the fire. Like, as soon as they start yelling and you know it's for you, you just keep going. Whether it's like good or not, like you just keep going just to keep hearing the noise. But it wasn't a distraction. It was more of like a worrisome thought. We're like, what can possibly be going on? But then after things settled down, we're like, they didn't do anything. Must have just been like a mistake or something. But no, I mean, the crowd played a lot into Worlds, honestly. Like just them yelling, hyping us up. You know, yelling when we make plays, yelling when they mess up. It's like, it's a big factor for us.
Now, were they hyping you up for this set, or was it only the final set when they were cheering USA the whole time?
The final set was a lot more catered towards us, fan base wise. This set was so odd. I don't know if I said this earlier, but Obey were a fan favorite because, you know, they have Prime, you know, Papa Prime, Ataraxia, Twig. They've been playing for ages. They're, you know, great people, big community people. And every time we beat them, we'd reset, you know, like mentally reset to game one, best of one, whatever. And we'd come back to the stage, we'd settle down. And as each member of Obey kept coming out, like, the crowd never stopped cheering. And we're like, we're up 1-0. We're up 2-0, and there's no cheers for United, none. And we're like, I mean, these guys are tough. Like, they have like a huge morale, huge reputation. So I guess like you can't count them out, especially with the crowd on your side in a competitive game. Like, it definitely is a boost.
Something I wanted to also talk about in this game, after the first blood, we didn't see like much action at all for 8 straight minutes. What was your team's game plan going into the late game?
So after the first blood, you could see in the net worth, my lead is pretty much completely diminished from the first blood, which I don't remember if it was bad farming on my side. It looks like they are out farming us on the map, but I did rotate. I did split a lot more than Ataraxia did. And I think we just chose to just cool it. Like, there's no reason to force anything stupid. You just got to wait till late game. We have Fafnir, one team play with Fafnir, you transform, you do Fire Giant, you win the game. And we have Ra, and they didn't punish the Ra at all with a tank Osiris. And I remember in game, we played against this once versus Homie Efe, or twice. He picked Osiris versus my Huyi, or like Huyi in general, and he went full tank. And I was like, give this 10 to 15 more minutes, and he won't do anything in this game. So I think we just stalled super hard. Just kept farming, no fights, no stupid decisions, you know, just play it safe and then get to late game and you win.
Then we talk about no action, but then over here, coming up around the 11-16 mark, you take a little 1v1 fight.
You gotta flex on him, right? Yeah. Assert some dominance. I was playing that corner because no ADC ever pays attention when they're walking around. Like, I got caught with it at Whirl in the finals game versus Rival. Or not finals, but in the game versus Rival, like, Vote gets a sick impale on me as well. And I just feel like playing corners like that, especially with gods that have one-shot potential, like Kuyi with the bounce off the wall, it's really good. I feel like people underutilize that, but I mean, I don't know. Forces actives, he forces mine. It's just an even trade.
And it's funny that allows you guys to take a lopsided fight, because by you forcing Ataraxia to back, he's like, he's life stealing off of his back camps. And then I wanted to talk about the Hunter meta for Worlds was Devo Gloves Aussie. What was the reasoning behind this?
I think it was to just bait and tank objectives. I don't completely remember, but I know like if you didn't go Aussie, you were in such a rough spot because the other Hunter would just, he would poke you out of lane. Eventually he would out life steal you. You didn't need to take long fights. And then the biggest thing was just sneaking objectives as a Hunter player. I mean, in scrims, I did it plenty of times where you leave your lane, like you back. So he's like, okay, the guy backed, he's gonna come back to base. You leave your wave, he clears it, or he so clears it because he's like zoning you. He's like, I'm zoning this guy, sick zone. And then seconds later, I get gold. And that's purely because of double lifesteal and being able to tank objectives and bait stuff like that.
So the first real straight up team fight happens around the 1350 mark, where you guys, with the game being very even, just straight up force a Gold Fury to funnel them in?
Yeah. Like I said earlier, this team of any team always walks into objectives because I don't blame them. The game is tied right now and they know they're on a time bomb. Like, if they don't win in the next 10 minutes, we win. So we're just like, just pull this, we're gonna bait him in. Salt's on a pretty big power spike. I had just finished my Aussie so I could tank objectives forever. And we have raw heal, which is the biggest thing here. We have raw heal, we just tank it up. You know, let him come in, poke him out. The only person on that team who can heal is Emilzy. So, you know, poke him out, step back, raw heal, pull it. They come back in like they're doing right now. And then we just go on him. And I think that was the game plan all along. Just let him funnel in, poke him. If they choose to come in and die, they die. If not, pull back to gold, heal, and do gold.
And now your point of view specifically, doing so much damage, and then you're thinking about going in. How bad did you want that?
I mean, Prime is 1 HP. I could have jumped in, but making a call like that or making a play like that is more risky than it is needed. Even me jumping forces him back, like me going into the air. So I'm probably just calling, like, do gold, like I'm doing so much damage. So even though I don't jump in, you know, I don't do the, like the crazy play, I think it's better for my team that I just force them out. I don't even do damage to the gold fury because I wasn't the burst. So I'm just sitting there hitting them with autos and, you know, forcing them back.
Very disciplined play from you, PandaCat. So now more action in the solo lane where things got a little bit hairy for you against this RDO.
This fight got me a little bit annoyed because I was out of range of the RDO 3 on my screen, or like I wasn't going to get crippled. And then I think I pressed my jump and he put me back down to the ground on my computer. And then the cripple lasted ages. And I was like, am I dead? Did I screw up? Did I throw the game? But then, you know, salt, carry,
Here, you jump back into the apple. Were you a little hungry or?
I mean, you gotta give Pretty Prime some damage, you know? I felt bad for the guy.
Fair enough. The next Gold Fury attempt happens around the 2015 mark, right about now. And it seems to be like a similar story where you're just focusing out a Milzy.
Yeah, I mean, he's super underleveled compared to me. I have Executioner. He has, what, one defense item? He has Sovereignty. So with my two, at the Mark of the Golden Crow, Aussie, Exe, and even the Lightblade. The Lightblade's a big deal on Huyi. I have so much attack speed to burst him down. So the call is like look at them doing it again. They funnel in, we Fenrir stun him, we pull him into the team. He can ult off reaction, or he didn't. Maybe he could have off the Fenrir jump sound, but Scream played it well enough to get him into us. And as soon as we get that pick, it's just like easy pickings, you know, just keep doing gold and keep doing our thing.
Yeah, you guys have plenty of burst damage with this Huyi to find picks like that.
Yeah, for sure.
So I like the baits there. The next fight on the opposite side of the map around this Portal Demon, no longer the Pyromancer of this year.
I miss Portal. That's a sick objective.
So I think that you guys forced them out. Benji takes a little bit of poke, and then the constitute Portal Demon.
Yeah, the Portal Demon was so broken at the time. Just because you could force a fight back and then come back full health. And like that was so underutilized or overutilized or well utilized by so many teams. And I mean, this is just a classic case of a Milzy walking in and just dying because we're doing any objective. This fight does get a little shaky towards the end here. Twig overcommits in my Aussie passive and I have a Raw Heal on me. And then I juke the Pretty Prime 2.
Sick juke, by the way.
I mean, I step forward intentionally.
And then your pop off right there.
Yeah.
Let's rewind that pop off real quick after the double kill there.
Go back
in the audio bit. Do you remember at all what you said?
It's probably like a curse word.
Oh, okay.
You know, kind of getting hyped.
We won't say that.
Yeah.
You know, in the moment.
In the moment, no hard feelings. Pretty Prime if you're watching this.
That was a nice little juke arena there. Also, the Phoenix Siege. So now after you guys get the Fire Giant, you guys going for your first Phoenix Siege in about right here. So what was the game plan for eUnited going into this middle Phoenix?
Just let me hit their front line. I'm pretty sure in my years of playing ADC, that is all I ever said. I never said dive back line. I'm like, please just hit what's in front of you. Let me do the damage, you know, peel back. And that was the game plan. I mean, I'm four levels on their Osiris, their tank Osiris, doing no damage. Yeah. I was like, just let me hit him, you know, bait him in, let me hit him, let him back up, we hit the Phoenix and heal. And that was pretty much it for the entire siege. Let their tanks come in, poke them, force actives, back up, heal, and rinse and repeat. Eventually, you get picks, you get actives, you get ults, and you either get the Phoenix or they die for it.
Easy peasy. You're forcing a Milzy all the way on the north side, defensive ultimate out of Captain Twig on the south side, and using that sustain to your fullest advantage. And that was your first Phoenix. And I took note of the player healing for Venenu. It was like about 15,500 healing in this game. That was a big deal.
I mean, the raw pick was perfect for what we were doing in this game specifically, aka pulling something, tanking a lot of damage from that, but being able to sustain it all back up through double lifesteal and raw healing. So it's no surprise that Ven did as much healing as he did because we didn't draft raw for him to pop off on damage, for him to one-shot people. We drafted raw for the idea that we're gonna pull an objective, we're gonna bait it, he's gonna heal us, and we're just gonna keep baiting until they mess up. So, I mean, just well played by Ven. You know, he even went Rod of Asclepius third item just because he knew, like, it doesn't matter how much damage he's doing as long as he's helping us.
Movement speed is never a bad thing.
Yeah, movement speed not a bad thing either, especially versus Osiris.
So the last Phoenix Siege before you guys do ultimately end the game was right here. And we get another glimpse of the PandaCat pop off and
I don't remember what I said here. I think I said something when we get him. That was a really bad Aegis by me. But yeah, I mean, the game plan is still the same. Huyi ulting so they can't walk up. I mean, we're diving a little deep here. This is a misplay by us. I think people are just getting a little eager to end. But Huyi ult their front line, zone them out, hit the Phoenix, somebody comes back in, eventually they die.
And then you wanted it again. You did a double take.
I could have jumped in and altered him, but like I said before, risk versus reward, probably not there.
Yeah.
Especially Ataraxia was staring right at me. Like I saw my peripheral vision, I'm like, I'm gonna kill you, Zalia. Then I go in the air and I see him like peek around the pillar. I'm like, lucky day for you.
So what did this win mean to you and eUnited? You said how you felt untouchable after this.
Yeah, I mean, I felt unstoppable, honestly. I mean, the gameplay showed for itself. I think we had the most dominant Worlds run in Smite, right? I think Energy had trouble with like Luminosity in one of the Worlds wins, or Panthera, I don't remember. But after beating Obey the first game, which was kind of shaky because they got an early lead and we were like, maybe they just threw. But like after a game like that where we just controlled the map so well, like it was like 43K versus 43K at one point, and then fast forward 5 minutes, we're up 10K. And like just playing it out, you know, playing so disciplined, just it really boosted all of our confidence. I was like, we're winning Worlds. Like we weren't afraid of Rival. And we were like, all we gotta do is just play our game, like smooth sailing through the sets, no throwing, no stupid decisions, which is why the games are so slow. And I was just like, we're gonna win, man. There's no way.
Yeah, you guys 3-0'd Obey, if I recall.
3-0'd Obey.
3-1'd Rival as well. Really impressive performance in the 2018 SWC. Well, thank you so much, Maxim PandaCat Janovic, for your time. Now mid laner for Rival, yeah. Former Hunter for eUnited. Do you miss playing Hunter at all?
A little bit. I mean, the only time I miss it is when I'm dead and I'm watching Kenny play it, or Arkle. I was like, that used to be my life. That used to be the easy life, just, you know, backstepping and auto-attacking. But it's okay. I'm having a lot of fun in mid for sure, so I'm not complaining.
Glad to hear it. Before we close the video, any shout-outs you want to give to the fans, your organization, and where can they find you at home?
I mean, shout-outs to Rival right now for being an amazing sponsor. Like, way better than anybody expected with such a big process. Not that I'm like taking shots at Rival, but like just how punctual they've been with payments and helping with us with everything, setting up everything. They've been great to work with. So shout outs to them. Shout outs to, I mean, all the fans, every supporter that we've had as a team, or anybody who supports me personally. And you know, make sure to follow me on Twitter at mpandacat. Follow me on Twitch at thepandacat, 2 E's. And you know, just keep doing you, you know.
Thank you again, PandaCat. Best of luck in Season 6.
Thank you.